Encore with Claire O'Brien, arts and entertainment for the Midlands.
Hello, 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 and you're listening to Encore on Midlands 103. Every Thursday night, we bring you the best of what's happening in the arts in Laois, Offaly, Westmeath, and sometimes, as we will tonight, a little bit further afield. Encore at midlands103.com is the email address if you'd like to get in touch with me. I'm Claire O'Brien, and I'd love to hear from you about what is floating your boat in the world of the arts and culture, and in heritage indeed, at the moment. We're going to start tonight with a little overview of what's on the show. We will be talking about Beyoncé and the two new songs that she dropped, as they say, earlier on this week at the Super Bowl. She has made a foray into country music. I'm really curious to hear what you'll think about the two songs, because I'll play them both for you a little bit later on. We'll also be talking to Andrea Mara. Andrea is a crime writer, and she will be at the library in Port Laois on Saturday the 24th of February. I'll be having a chat with her there at 2 o'clock about her most recent book, No One Saw a Thing. But it's part of a celebration for Ireland Reads, and great opportunity for you to, as they say on the tagline, get lost in a book and take an opportunity to find your way back into fiction or non-fiction. A lot of people really struggled, I think, during lockdown. I'm still hearing from people saying, yeah, I kind of got out of the habit during lockdown, or over lockdown, I kind of stopped reading and I haven't really gotten back into it. Now's your chance. And I'll be talking to the director at Portumna Players, because they are bringing to Birr on Saturday night a brand new play by Westmeath writer Jimmy Keary. It's called Marrying Mike. It sounds absolutely hilarious. And it's on, as I say, in Birr Theatre on Saturday night. So I'll be chatting to Pamela there about that. So that's all still to come on the show. As always, we'll give you a bit of an update about what's happening locally. If you want to fill up your cultural arts diary for the week, a new exhibition opening tomorrow at the Lewin Gallery. Really, really interesting. We'll be talking about that on the programme next week. In the Mullingar Arts Centre on Saturday night, the Furies will be playing. And then the following weekend, which is again the weekend of the 23rd, 24th, there's a new play coming, and it is from Tommy Maron. Now, I'm looking forward to talking to Tommy on the programme in the next couple of weeks. But the play is called Matches and Old Flames, and they're always hilariously funny and always draw a huge crowd. So that is at Mullingar Arts Centre next weekend. David McSavage is at the Dean Crow Theatre tomorrow night, and on Sunday they're having one of their In the Spotlight events featuring local performers, young people, singer-songwriters. It's also worth noting, if you have a Leaving Cert student in the house, it's a different one for fifth year, that Cyclone Rep Theatre are doing their Hamlet experience in Athlone on Thursday and Friday at the Dean Crow Theatre. Now, it's not a performance of Hamlet. It's a slightly different thing. Really looking forward also to seeing Ian McKellen's new performance of Hamlet. It's actually a film, but it's filmed all around the theatre. We'll talk about that, I think, a little bit later on in the next couple of weeks in the programme, but it looks spectacular. In Tullamore, Esker Arts Centre, the Rock of Ages are finishing up on Saturday. Now, you may have been one of the very lucky people who managed to scoop up a ticket for that production by Tullamore Musical Society. And on Saturday, there is a bookmaking workshop, which looks really, really interesting. Tonight at the Dunamase Theatre, you can catch Andy Irvine and Donal Lunny, and on Saturday night's Legends of American Country Music. Now, speaking of Dunamase, next Thursday night I will be here in Tullamore presenting the programme, but if I could be anywhere else in the world, it would be at Dunamase, because Michael Murphy is bringing the third play in the Man in Woman's Shoes series. It's called The Mysterious Case of Kitsy Rainey, and Michael is just such a phenomenal performer, and Kitsy Rainey a terrific character, and those three plays, The Man in Woman's Shoes, and this one here as well, The Mysterious Case of Kitsy Rainey, as I say, if I could be anywhere other than here next Thursday night, that is where I will be, and as soon as I can catch it, I will be there. Michael is a terrific writer and super performer, and it'll be hilariously funny as well and very moving. We are going to take a little break. before we come back to some Beyoncé. And to do that, we will take some music. And this is from Andy Irvine and from Donal Lunny. It's called The Blind Harper. You're listening to Encore on Midlands 103.
Encore with Find Local Jobs. Find your perfect work-life balance at findlocaljobs.ie.
Well, that was Texas Hold'em. Now, I've heard it a couple of times and it is a real worm. It's a real earworm. It's really growing on me. Why are we playing this? Well, it was released during the Verizon commercial at the Super Bowl the other night. On Tuesday then, already it had made it to the top of the Apple Country Music charts, making Beyoncé the first black woman to top the Apple Country Music charts. Forbes, however, have been reporting that country music stations across America have been much, much slower to pick it up or to play it. And it's kind of interesting. The second song they've been, has been less well received. It's called 16 Carriages. I'll play it for you a little bit later on in the programme. But it just struck me how audacious it was to use that advertisement for Verizon to drop two new songs. And it brought me back to this conversation that I had with Mick Lynch recently. Now, we were chatting, you heard it last week on the programme, about the Eurovision, but we also delved into the Grammys and what had been happening there. And we were talking particularly about musicians using their platforms and their moment on the podium for reasons other than saying thanks to all of those who were involved in particular projects with them. But when we were chatting about the Grammys, Mick and I started our conversation with Joni Mitchell. And really interesting, the contrast here, I think. For both of us, it was the standout moment of the night. Really understated. And worth finding on YouTube if you haven't had a chance to see it. But that kind of a performance and that kind of performer, in contrast with the Taylor Swifts and the Beyoncés, have a listen and see what you think.
Yeah, that would have been my standout. And I think anyone realised or witnessing history there, watching, she won her, obviously, the Grammy for Best Folk Album, which I was delighted about. And she, just to see her on the stage after what she's been through over the last couple of years and come back and learn to walk and learn to talk and sing again, and to perform there with Brandy Carlile, did On Both Sides Now, which, as we all know, is an absolute beautiful song anyway. Yeah. But to see her sitting there, you know, 82 years of age or whatever she is, she's definitely 80, and I just thought, wonderful, and the voice still sounded good, you know.
It did. It sounded. Didn't sound like it used to, and you can imagine that. How could it?
Yeah.
But the performance was electrifying.
Yes, and I think she was able to capture every single person. Like, You watch around, you see all the Taylor Swifts and all these people standing there looking at her, all in awe, realising, hang on, you know, she paved the way for all these female artists, especially any of them in the folk genre and stuff.
Yeah.
But she paved the way for a lot of them, and they're all looking at her and going, we all know that song. Doesn't matter what age you are, you know that song. And I'm a huge fan of her.
Yeah.
And I just thought, I tears in my eyes, I'm not
me
lying,
too,
definitely.
No, yeah.
You know, I just thought, a very emotional performance.
Yeah.
And the other one that would have jumped out for me would be Billy Joel.
Okay.
I'm a huge Billy Joel fan, and
yeah,
the big thing for him was, that was he stopped writing lyrics to his songs 30 years ago, after the River of Dreams album.
Yeah.
And ironically, the last song he wrote and put on River Dreams was called Famous Last Words. And he knew that when he was writing it, he said, I'm giving up writing. I'm still doing music, but he'd no interest putting lyrics to them.
Right.
And very unusual for someone that's been around that long, that for the last 30 years we've had no vocal, you know, from him. So to come back with this song, Turn the Lights Back On, he came on and performed it, and it's your typical piano man type,
yeah,
song. One man sitting at a piano, playing an intro, playing a song, no gimmicks, no whistles and bells. And, you know, it went down a storm, and he done, obviously, You May Be Right, which is one that's been covered by Garth Brooks and other people.
Yeah.
People might know it by them. So, and both of them I know are veterans, but I'm a huge, like, Taylor Swift fan as well, and I love Olivia Rodrigo. So,
now, that
you
was
know,
a great performance. The Olivia Rodrigo's was a great performance.
Lovely.
And I thought what was really interesting, the production was so good.
when Taylor Swift made her announcement, you know, she won the album of the year. And the she was talking then about thanking the fans, and she had an announcement for the fans, that which is that she has a new album, and I'm just going now backstage to drop the cover. And the camera, I don't know how the editing is done, but it went around the room to the other women who had been in that category, and you could see, I can't remember who else was there, but certainly...
They were all in it, Olivia Rodrigo, Dua Lipa, probably Cesar,
And Miley Cyrus was there. And they all, they were trying really, really hard to smile, but it was almost as if you could get the sense from all of them together that, like, when are we going to get a break? What do we have to do?
Yes. And would you believe, last week I was kind of predicting the winners of the top four, and I did call the record of the year for Flowers and one or two others the best producer on that. But when it came to album of the year, Midnights from Taylor is the only album in that category that I would have listened to constantly, and I know every song on it. But I still didn't think she was going to win it. I actually went for Olivia Rodrigo because I thought the Grammy... I know I should vote, give it to the best album, but I just thought they're looking for, you know, as you said, you've summed it up there. They want someone, a new kid on the block type thing. And to have won four is absolutely amazing. I just, I suppose I was comparing that album to Taylor's other albums, and it's probably not as good as some of her others, but it's still good enough to win album of the year. And I don't know if you saw Jay-Z coming on giving out
about
that.
Just about to ask you about that. Standing up for his lady.
Standing up for his lady, fair enough. But I thought he was taught, now obviously Taylor hadn't won it at this stage, but he was kind of having a go at, you know, that Beyonce had won these 32 Grammys, the most of anyone ever won, but still never had won Album of the Year. And I was kind of thinking, well, there's a lot of people in even in sports and in music and in any event, someone can dominate one era of it. Like someone can win the Premiership loads of times, but never win the FA Cup. So it's kind of, I just thought from him, I felt sorry for Beyonce because I could see she was cringing as if to say, you've said enough. But he, I thought it was unnecessary, you know.
And I wonder,
she
though...
She was having to go at the Academy.
Yeah, I wonder though, is it difficult for her, the way she crosses so many genres? Because certainly listening to the to the five R&B songs that were up for the R&B Song of the Year, I was thinking, they just all sound the same. You know, and there was nothing as edgy or as really as clever as what and as stylish and as well produced as what Beyonce can do. Does she just fall between the stools in terms of where she could be nominated for that, or am I misunderstanding it?
No, I think like she's still as popular as ever. And when her albums come out, I do have a quick listen to them, and I suppose I jump on the hit singles and listen to them more so. But I don't know, maybe, like, the other way I look at it, if you're the most nominated and you're the most, you've won the most Grammys, and if you haven't got Album of the Year, sometimes it could be down to, people only get to vote, I think people get to only, the 11,000 voters for the Grammys only get to vote for 11 categories or something. Now, there's about 90 categories. Yeah, there's over 90. And so they can only vote for 11. Now, a lot of them will try and get their vote in for the big one. And then I think there's a second round, because if everyone just votes in the first 10 categories, there's nothing else to vote for. But yeah, there's you're only allowed to vote in 10 of them. So some of those Beyonce people could be voting for Single of the Year, for a Song of the Year, or, you know, Record of the Year, Best Producer. So there's a lot of other categories. Obviously, the one to highlight, everyone wants to win, is Album of the Year. Of course it is.
So that was 16 Carriages, the second song that was dropped at the Super Bowl by Beyonce recently. Will it, along with Texas Hold'em, when they appear on her new album, which is out at the end of March, it's called Renaissance Act 2, will that make the ticket to the Grammys next year? Will it win Album of the Year? Well, we'll have to wait and find out. In the meantime, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, it is to a new Jimmy Keery play that is coming to Birr this weekend. You're listening to Encore on Midlands 103.
Encore, in association with Find Local Jobs. Need to give your career some tender loving care? Make the next move at findlocaljobs.ie. Midlands 103.
And you're very welcome back to Encore. Still to come on the programme, I'll be chatting to crime writer Andrea Mara about her most recent book. It's called No One Saw a Thing. Well, if you're in Birr this weekend, you'll have an opportunity to see something brand new. And that is a play written by the Westmeath's own Jimmy Keary and performed by Portumna Players. It's called Marrying Mike. And I spoke recently to director Pamela Sellers from Portumna Players to find out, first of all, how they got hold of a brand new Jimmy Keary play.
Well, what happened was I actually was contacting Jimmy to get another script of his called Finding Keepers at the start of September. And I just texted him to say, look, would you be able to send on the script to me for Finders Keepers? And he did. Now, he emailed it on to me. He also asked, he also mentioned on the email that he'd written two further plays. Now, he didn't attach those to the email, but of course, me being me, I took the opportunity to go back straight away to ask him, could he send on the other two to me? And one of those was Mary and Mike. So I read the other two, but when I read Mary and Mike, I think I was two or three pages into it, and I was laughing at it. So I said, this would be the play for us, for some of the players to put on for the winter production. So that's how it came about, really.
And they must have been delighted. They must have been delighted in the players to hear that they were getting the opportunity to perform a brand new play, and certainly one that had you giggling from the opening pages.
Yeah, when I told the rest of the members that we were, that I'd been in contact with Jimmy and we were going to be putting on his new play, Mary and Mike, they were all delighted. They were actually they were very excited because they had put on a premiere before of one of Jimmy's plays. I think it was The Two Loves of Gabriel Foley, which was on a few years ago in Portumna. So they were absolutely delighted that we got the opportunity to put on another one of his plays as a premiere. So it was very well received. Everybody was very excited about it.
So tell me about the play itself. What's the storyline? Who are the main characters? And God love them, tell us about Mike.
So the play centres around bachelor farmer Mike Fogarty. So he has land and he has money, despite appearances to the contrary. And he suddenly announces that he's looking to a friend, for a wife to his so-called friend Barney. Now Barney, who is a bit of a schemer, decides that his sister Colette, a woman with a reputation, would be the perfect wife for Mike. Kate, Mike's friend in the situation, and two other characters, Colm and Damien. And there's a bit of a love triangle that goes on around the farmhouse. And then you have the religious neighbour Madge.
she's quite a small part,
but a very important part in the grand scheme of things.
Okay.
The story centres around Mike trying to find a wife and how it all comes about. So that's pretty much it. I can't give too much away now.
No, of course not. Of course not. It sounds like everybody has an agenda. Everybody around him. Does he have any really proper, decent, good friend at all? Or would that be spoiling the story?
It wouldn't. I suppose Kate O'Sullivan would be a true friend of his. She'd be in his corner the whole time. So she'd be his main support in it.
Yeah. And you were laughing at the script from the first couple of pages. What was so entertaining about it? What had you so convinced that, yeah, this is the one that Portumna Players are going to do this year?
I just saw from the first couple of pages that I read that I think that the audience would have enjoyed it. We would enjoy doing it. I actually, just some of the characters you could actually nearly relate to people in the locality. You could say, oh, yeah, well, Mike would be such a person. You know, everybody would know a Mike, everybody would know a Barney, everybody would know a Colm, a Kate, and so on, and Madge and the whole lot. You could just see that it was written with a locality sense of mind kind of thing.
Yeah.
That it could be written about any town or any village in Ireland, and everybody would know the characters in it.
And your Mike eventually ended up being an awfully man, Tony Carroll from Kennedy. With a great acting heritage behind him.
Tony, in fairness to him, he's been a member of the Birr State Guild for over 20 years. He is now living in Portumna, and we approached him to read for the play. And He came down the first night, handed him the script. He read, asked him to read in, got into the character of Mike straight away. So there was no question of who Mike was going to be. It was going to be Tony. He just got into the character. That was it. Full stop. And never has never got back out of the character, if you ask me. Kill me now for saying that.
ask you about that? You know, when you have the opportunity then to be the group that does the first performance of this, you know, we know that Jimmy has told us before in the programme he tries to get to see performances and sometimes even rehearsals of his plays. Did he come along to see any of the rehearsals or indeed the performance itself?
He did. He came along on the opening night, and we got him to speak afterwards, and he spoke about the audience, how it was well received by them, and obviously congratulations to cast and so on. And he liked it so much, he came back a second night. We had a run of four nights, and he came back on the Sunday night, and because he enjoyed it so much, and he was texting me every night after each performance, asked me how, you know, the nights that he wasn't there, how it went down, how the audience received it. And in fairness to the audience, every single night we couldn't have asked for better. They laughed when they were supposed to laugh. They, you know, they were clapped when they were supposed to clap. They were, in fairness to the four nights of the audiences that we had, they were absolutely brilliant audiences. And for us as cast and crew, listening to the laughter and, I suppose, the applause, it makes the work very worthwhile for us. So I suppose to give a big thank you to Jimmy for writing the play in the first place and allowing us to put it on as well as the premiere.
So that's fantastic. That's terrific that he came and that he enjoyed it and came back a second time. So what can the audience in Birr expect if they toddle along to the Birr Theatre and Arts Centre on Saturday night, I think it is, to catch this? What can they expect?
Yeah, it's on the 17th in the Birr Theatre. It is going to be a night of laughter. It's going to be a nice surprise as well. There's a few surprises thrown in it. It'll certainly keep them entertained. And great night out at the theatre. Yes, it is. I should say that we're all, the cast and crew, we're really looking forward to bringing it to Birr. We're excited to bring it to Birr, and hopefully that everybody will have a great night and enjoy it as much as we enjoyed putting it on for them.
And there you go. That is Pamela Sellers of Portumna Players on Marrying Mike, the new play by Jimmy Keary, which you can see at Birr Theatre this weekend. All the details on the Birr Theatre website. After the break, I'll be talking to crime writer Andrea Mara. Stay with us on Encore.
Encore. Thanks to Find Local Jobs. Take training seriously. Find great courses in your area now at findlocaljobs.ie.
Midlands 103. And you're very welcome back to Encore. Crime writer Andrea Mara has just published what I think is her eighth novel. It came out in May. It's called No One Saw a Thing. I was chatting to her very recently ahead of an event that is happening in the library in Portlaoise on the 24th of February to mark Ireland Reads Day. I'll be chatting to Andrea at 2 o'clock there at the library, but I caught up with her during the week to check in with her about the book and I suppose what is, for a thriller, an absolutely terrifying premise.
Well, it comes from real life, although it wasn't quite as dramatic. It was when I was in London on holidays with my family when I was about 12. And, like, you know, it was our first time in London, so we were very clueless about what we were doing. And myself and my younger sister, who was 6 at the time, we jumped on a tube and the doors slid shut and the tube took off before my parents and our other 2 sisters could get on. So there was a passenger beside us who said, "I don't know if you heard, but your dad was shouting Tower Bridge through the door." So that person told us when we got to Tower Bridge and put us off the train. And then my parents and my other sisters caught up with us. I don't know how long after. I'd say not long because I'm not traumatized. But I don't even remember a whole lot about the actual incident. It's more the retelling of the story over the years. And we got my dad to remind us of the story just a couple of years back. and he told the whole thing again. And I was like, Dad, why did you send us to Tower Bridge? Were you in that much of a rush to get on with your day tripping that you wouldn't have just said next stop? But yeah, all ended very quickly and quietly and happily for us. So I had to make it a little bit more dramatic for the book.
Yeah, I was just about to say it obviously sowed a seed of something terrifying in your own mind when it came to your own writing.
Yeah, like I think more so as a parent now myself, when my dad retold the story a few years back, I thought, oh my God, I'd always thought about it only from my perspective, as you know, children do, we kind of only think about ourselves. And I had never really stopped to think about how it must have been for my parents. It was like the late 80s, no mobile phones, and we didn't know London at all. And, you know, in a city of 8 million people and that warren of tunnels in the underground, I'd say it was absolutely terrifying for them. So it made me think then, how would I feel if I was in London with my kids and that happened? And that's what gave me the idea for the book then, to take sort of an everyday thing that could easily happen and has happened to lots of people, because lots of people messaged me after reading the book and said, oh my God, something like that happened to me. Or even, you know, a simple thing like people message me saying a toddler getting on a lift in a hotel and the door is closed. And it doesn't sound all that scary, but if you've got a 2-year-old and you've got maybe a 15-story hotel and you don't know which floor they're going to get out on, that's even terrifying. So yeah, it's that idea of a relatable everyday problem where something goes badly wrong.
And it's not just that the initial event happens, it's that all of the other events that happen afterwards add to the terror and to the tension.
Yeah, so like this is all in the blurb and the first chapter, so it's not a spoiler to say that when Sive, the main character, gets to the next stop, she's been told everything is okay, come to the next stop, your kids are here, everything is fine. And when she gets there, she sees her 2-year-old Bia, and she picks her up and she hugs her, and she's kind of wondering, gosh, I wonder, will the staff be okay that I just take her? Is the hug enough? Will they trust that I am her mom? And then she thinks, oh, Faye will tell them. Faye is her 6-year-old. And she looks around and she says to staff, where's Faye? And they say, who's Faye? And that's when her world completely falls apart, because the other daughter wasn't on the train when the train stopped. And yeah, it goes on from there for the rest of that long day in London. Sive and her husband Aaron are searching everywhere for their daughter Faye, but also unraveling what might have happened. Was it something accidental, something opportunistic, or was it something planned? Has someone done this deliberately, and if so, why?
And as a mum and as a writer, taking a story like that to its denouement can't be an easy thing. And the people say you should always write what you know, but you're writing kind of things that you don't want to know.
Yeah, but that's the beauty of it. Like, it's cathartic. Like, it really is. Like, I'm someone who literally every day I think, oh my God, but what if, about things. And, you know, what if, like, I dropped my keys in the lift in Lidl today, and I thought, oh, what if they had fallen down the crack and I couldn't go home, and then my son was at home on his own because he arrived home, you know, whatever. And so the writing of it in a book is a way to get it out of my system. So I actually really enjoy doing that. I don't find that difficult to live out my worst nightmare in a book, because it's definitely easier to live it out in the book than it is to live it out in real life. And I think that's why we read thrillers as well. It's because you get to live out your worst fears, but in fiction, and there's usually almost always a satisfying and reverse tempt fate or realism, where if you're reading it in a book or writing it for a book, it's not going to happen in real life, we hope.
This, I think, is your 8th novel after a huge leap of faith from a very different kind of world that you were working in. Tell us about that journey briefly.
So I was working in financial services very, very happily. I loved my job. I was there for 17 years, and it was for a French bank in Ireland, and they decided they were going to relocate the business we were looking after to Luxembourg and to India and to close the Dublin office. So I was absolutely devastated. I felt like the rug had been well and truly pulled from underneath me, and I was horrified that I'd have to, you know, leave my lovely, lovely job and all the really lovely people I worked with. But it was the nudge that I needed. And I had been blogging for a while at that stage, but semi-anonymously, like I was blogging about work and juggling kids and family and childcare and all the rest of it. And it was a chance then to give it a go, to move into writing as a job. So if I hadn't been made redundant, I would probably still be happily working away on my spreadsheets and my emails every day in financial services and not remotely trying to write a book. But what seemed like very bad news at the time turned out to be really life-changing in a really, really positive way.
And the publication journey, you've written, is it six books now with Transworld?
This is my sixth book altogether. Yeah. Three were with Poolbeg and the next three were with Transworld. And I have more coming with Transworld now in the coming years.
Yeah. So what's it like now to have left that world of being in financial services and to be in the world of writers and crime writers, particularly because we all know that they have a really tight circle, a great group of people to be connected with, the Jane Caseys and the Liz Nugents and the Patricia Gibneys and the Andrea Carters of the world, form a really tight knit circle of writers.
Yeah, we're really lucky. Like there's a big group of Irish crime writers, a lot of women crime writers in Ireland at the moment, and like we all get on really, really well, which is like sometimes people don't believe that because they assume everybody is in competition with each other. And of course, like if your book comes out the same day as someone else and if you both were hoping to get to the number one spot in the charts and there's only one number one that week, but you know, those situations are very, very rare. And for the most part, it's a friendly competition, friendly rivalry, but what's much more important is the like camaraderie and the connectivity, because we're all working from home in our own bedrooms and home offices, and we don't have colleagues to talk to. We've nobody to talk to. We're just on a laptop all day, every day. So when we get a chance to go to a book launch or a festival, it's an amazing chance to catch up in real life. And it's just kind of nonstop talk with everybody, you know, passing the latest industry gossip over and back and who did what and who signed with which publisher and so on. And it's absolutely brilliant. And I absolutely love it so far. I mean, I liked my job in financial services, but I love this life in publishing. Like it's an exciting life. Like you never know when you're going to get an amazing email. Like today's paperback publication day for No One Saw a Thing. So you caught me on a good day. And it has just been announced as a Richard and Judy book club pick. So I'm really excited about that. And like, that's just an email that I got telling me this really, really good news. Whereas in my old job, much as I enjoyed the job, no one ever emailed me to tell me I was a Richard and Judy book club pick.
Well, there is that. We are speaking today ahead of a conversation that you and I will have next weekend. That is the 24th of February in the library in Portlaoise at 2 o'clock to mark Ireland Reads, the Ireland Reads Festival. Can I ask you just before we finish up, what are you reading or what do you read in general?
So I read a lot of advanced copies of books that are coming out that are sent to me by different writers and publishers. And it's like a nonstop stream of books, which is brilliant. I read a lot of crime then because of that, because it's crime writers sending me books. So I love an opportunity every now and then to grab something different, like an Emily Henry book or Sophie White's book, just something that's not crime for a change. And the book I'm reading right now is All of Us Are Broken by Fiona Cummins, which isn't an advanced proof. It's one that's out already and people can buy it. And it is so beautifully written. It's a kind of a Bonnie and Clyde style thriller. It's dark and terrifying, but the writing is absolutely beautiful. And if one can say it's possible to enjoy a terrifying Bonnie and Clyde style story, I am really, really enjoying this.
And there is your recommendation. That book that Andrea mentioned is called All of Us Are Broken by Fiona Cumins. And her own book, the one that we'll be chatting about in the library in Portlaoise, the most recent one that came out in May and is now Richard and Judy even, book club choice, is called No One Saw a Thing. That is it from Encore for this evening. Thank you for the pleasure of your company, and thanks indeed to all of our guests here on the show. We are staying with writing next week because I'll be talking to Kathy Kelly about her new book. We'll also be looking at a new exhibition that will have launched between now and then at the Lewin Gallery in Athlone. So that's all to come next week on the programme. The great Joe Cooney, I do believe, is in the building and ready to bring you the best of Irish and American country music. I'll be back in this seat again next week. Until then, take care of yourself. Good night.